Hello everyone and welcome back to The Lurking Horror, and this will probably be the final episode. Last time, or rather in between episodes, I had to look a little bit around because I forgot the flask. The flask was actually nearby, in fact it's still in the dialogue as you can see, but it was in the dark area, so I did think about that it wouldn't be shown when you actually just pass it, otherwise the game indicates when items are around, but well, never mind. So let's go down. And the reason we're going down again is because we used the elevator to rip a new hole into... Okay, so let's turn on the flashlight here. Into the wall here. Well, should probably spell it correctly. That would definitely help. There we go. The southern brick wall has an enormous hole ripped into it. So that's what we did. So let's go west here into the steam tunnel. And if you haven't been here before, the rats will actually be here again. The tunnel continues west from here, becoming narrow, muddy and forbidding. The walls no longer seem to be finished as they were. The steam pipe and coaxial cable disappear into the ceiling at this point. The temperature has dropped considerably as well. Yeah, if you don't... if you don't kill the rats beforehand, then you need to kill them now. The tunnel you came through continues down, barely large enough to enter. It's made of sticky gelatinous mud that's been pushed by something into a semblance of a passage. Okay, let's go down. Large chamber. This is a white spot in the tunnel, just as wet and muddy as elsewhere. The walls are slimy as well. Numerous slots or indentations, about 2 feet wide and a foot high, open here and there. Thin wire or rope-like rows emerge from a hole further down and enter each of the slots. There's a background noise here, almost loud enough to hear clearly. A small, furtive motion attracts your attention to the slots. Okay, that's interesting. But first let's use our new cutter. You strain and push the two handles of the bolt cutter together with all your strength. At first it looks like nothing will happen, but then, with a loud click, the jaws cut the wire. The wire, as though under tension, rapidly begins to curl up, disappearing down the tunnel and away. Urchins burst forth from the slots. The effect on the urchin is electric, perhaps literally. They twitch, jerk spasmodically, and fall to the ground almost in unison. They have lost all interest in you. That is good, because otherwise this is another situation where you can simply die. So let's go down now that it's safe. A few of the urchins grab feebly as you pass, but none as a serious barrier. If you don't do that beforehand, then they're going to get you. Wet tunnel. You're lost in narrow wet tunnels burrowed through the mud. Muddy, oily water covers the floor. The hand points its mutilated ring finger north and grips your shoulder tightly. So let's go north. You're lost in narrow wet tunnels burrowed through the mud. Muddy, oily water covers the floor. Okay, so let's go down. So the hand indicates where you have to go. I'm not quite sure whether you can do it without the hand. Of course, you could just know where you need to go. But it could be that the maze is designed in a way that you can't even now get through here without those instructions. The hand points your mutilated ring from yourself and grips your shoulder tightly. Okay. A curtain of moldy slime covers the south wall. So, open the flask. This is where we need to get the flask in the first place. You open the flask and a cold white mist boils out. Because apparently this flask just contains magic or whatever. We'll see. The liquid splashes onto the curtain and a cold mist fills the room. The slime begins to freeze. Nearly the entire curtain solidifies, shatters and drops to the ground, revealing an ancient wooden door. Now, this could be liquid nitrogen, but you wouldn't keep a liquid nitrogen in a regular flask. You'll keep it in a deva, but whatever, let's not question it. So let's just drop the flask. And let's also drop the cutter. And let's drop the knife. So, let's open the door. Of course it's locked. Let's unlock the door with our master key, which still is a semi-skeleton key. So, let's drop the key because we won't need it afterwards. And let's open the door. Okay, the ancient door is now open. And the ancient door is not ancient enough that the master key doesn't work here. As you enter, the door closes and locks behind you. The floor here is a stagnant, slime-infested pool of water. It feels to be about 6 inches deep. Ropes or wires tumble down the slope, where they enter a large, whitish mass which takes up much of the chamber. The noise is loud here, and comes from the mass, which undulates in synchronicity with the noise. When sources light illuminate the chamber. Set on the wall, in congruous with the surroundings, is a metal box. On one side, a coaxial cable enters the box. On the other, a cable-like appendage leads from the box to the mass. There's a metal cover on the box. Suddenly, the hand leaps from your shoulder into the slime-encrusted puddle. It dives beneath the water. Let's check out that box. You remove the cover, revealing a plethora of electronic innards. Most prominent are a socket into which a coaxial cable is plugged and a connector into which the glistening cable-like appendages disappear. You hear noises outside the door. The hand repeatedly dives and bobs to the surface in one part of the pool near your feet. So, we need to remove the coaxial cable. You unscrew the cable. It now hangs unconnected inside the box. You hear a stumbling noise behind you. Turn and see the hacker stagger into the cavern. The hacker stares at you shocked. It's you! When I gave you my key, I never expected you'd get this far. The hand repeatedly dives and bobs to the surface in one part of the pool near your feet. Okay, so this is an interesting development. So let's reach into the water here. You root around blindly in the gooey, slimy water. You feel something thick and slippery. A tentacle? No, it's cold and dead. It seems to be a line of some kind, just below the surface. Decker stares at the thing in the cave. I got very suspicious about your problems with the net. I began to trace some cokes, found some repeaters and bridges that weren't on the layout charts, and started following them. Anyway, here I am. The thing there, whatever it is, and those wires are interfaced. It's the whole campus net. That means it's tied to all the nets, commercial, government, even military, potentially. So yeah, this turned from Lovecraft into Lovecraft plus Bloodnet, or late 80s, early 90s hacking. Well, that said, let's do something about this. Let's get that line. You pull a length of the line out of the water. It's like holding a large heavy snake. I guess I better do something. It could be a serious compromise of system integrity if this thing isn't dealt with. He peers at the mass, as if evaluating it. He then reaches into a pocket and pulls out a small pair of wire strippers. So, let's count that line. You strike the line with the axe, making a deep gash into insulation. And I think the axe is full metal, so I think you should wear the glove before you do that. The hacker advances on the mass, apparently planning to cut stumps of wires leading into it. As he approached it, the sound stops completely, and the wires begin a frantic, looping, twining dance. The mass begins to flow towards the hacker almost as quickly as he walks away. Towards it. They reach each other and begin to merge together. He screams, a long, ululating cry that echoes through the cavern. Then he hears, engulfed. Your blow cuts through more insulation and into the conductors. The mass is bulging, vibrating, and gripping. The line parts. The two ends begin to sink towards the water as they straighten out. The mass bulging, vibrating, and rippling. So let's grab that line. You carefully grab the line just as it's about to drop into the water. The mass is bulging, vibrating, rippling. A huge tear is forming near where the hacker was absorbed. So put the line into the connector. You shove the exposed conductors into the socket, producing a shower of sparks. The tentacle connected to the other socket begins to jerk and twitch spasmodically. The mass it's connected to quivers and a horrible noise, almost like a huge machine running without oil, issues from the thing. The mass begins to change shape, compacting, darkening. You can briefly see human outlines within the grey, gelatinous mass. They surround something larger, of a shape not human, not animal, like nothing you've ever seen before. The gelatinous mass solidifies and compacts, leaving behind a litter of smoking debris. In the debris squat, a being, huge misshapen, it stares at you with baleful yellow eyes. Its scaly wings beat slowly, driving a fetid stench through the stale air of the cavern. A barbed tongue starts across its broken, dagger-like fangs. The smooth stone vibrates. It starts to feel warm. So, let's wait a moment. Time passes. The thing tenses, preparing to leap. Its mouth opens, revealing not the glistening interior, but a dead black outline into a hole into nothingness. The smooth stone is now glowing with a bright red heat that nevertheless fails to burn you. So, that stone has helped us before to thwart a supernatural creature, so let's try that again. The thing tenses, preparing to leap. Its mouth opens, revealing not the glistening terror, but a dead black outline into a hole into nothingness. And I'd already read that. The stone smashes into the creature, sticking it its ichorous hide. The thing thrashes about, trying to bite at the stone, which is glowing brighter and brighter. Small hands issue from beneath its scales to tongue and vine at the irritant. The creature begins to show gaping holes of dark light, devouring nothingness around the stone. Its wings spread painfully, as though it were trying to fly away, and then fold. It widens its jaw in an almost human scream of agony. The black hole of its maw overwhelms it, and indeed the creature appears to be swallowing itself. At last, a grey cloud of greasy smoke surrounds the glowing stone, still suspended in mid-air. Then even that vanishes, and the stone drops to the ground, no longer glowing. The thing is gone. So let's take the stone. You pick up the stone. It has a long, jagged crack that almost breaks it in half. As you pick it up, you feel it bump to one side. Then, as you are holding it in your hand, something pushes its way out through the cracks, breaking the stone into two pieces. Something small, pale and damp, blinks its watery eyes at you. It hisses, gaining strength, and spreads membranous wings. It takes into the air, at first clumsily, then with increasing assurance, and disappears into the gloom. One eerie cry drifts back to where you stand. Something rises out of the mud, slowly straightening. The hacker, mud-covered and weak, stares to its feet. "Can I have my key back?" he asks. "Your score is 100 out of possible 100, in 565 moves, which is a lot more moves than you can use to complete the game, even including the urchin, but I had to go back and look for some stuff. Grade the curve. You're in the class of President of the Institute. Would you like to restart the game from the beginning, restore save game position, or end the session of the game?" So yeah, that was The Lurking Horror. It's actually pretty solid for its time. I wish it would recognize a couple more commands, but generally it's not too bad. It recognizes quite a lot of things. It does have one or two puzzles that are not intuitive at all, and I think the main annoyance here is that they are life and death puzzles, but apart from that, it's actually quite a decent game. The sound effects add a lot, in my opinion. And the first time I played this game, I didn't see them coming, so they really made me jump. Overall, I would recommend this game if you like text adventures. If not, I'm afraid this is not going to convince you. I think it's a good game, but you really have to like text adventures. Otherwise, this is not going to be for you. So yeah, thanks for watching. And I shall see you next time. Take care and goodbye.